Good morning, church. Welcome to our Easter service. I know you're all at home, and we miss you, and love you guys. We just want to join together in worship this morning, but I want to just ask you just a question. It's been a while since we've been able to talk together, and I just want to know what you all are missing. Since we don't get to talk, just make some comments on the video and just put on there what you're missing right now. What's some things that you really are missing being together and different things. One thing that I'm missing, as you can see, is a haircut. It's one thing that I'm really dreading. Pastor Justin and I have the same hairstylist over in Bastrop, and he got his in before this whole thing went down, and I was way behind at that point. So, and actually, our friend Stuart Lee, on Monday, when I arrived out to work at the church property out there, he's like, "Every time I see you, you look more and more like Moses." And I don't think that was a compliment. So, anyway, let's worship together. Let's have some fun singing. And, you know, God's still in control. One thing I really miss, truly, honestly, is seeing y'all on Sunday mornings. It's been kind of a weird time. And I just want you all to know that we miss you and love you and look forward to when we can meet again. So let's worship together.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? The power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's time. There's wonderful power in the blood. Service for Jesus, your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you lift daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious.
A new song to you this morning, church. It's a song we've been wanting to do for quite a while. It's called King of Kings. It's chock full of lots of scripture through the book of Acts, through Romans, through 1 Peter. And anyway, it's a great song called King of Kings.
In the darkness, we were waiting. Without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Three in one, God. passion, Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. Crown of glory, majesty, praise forever the King of Kings. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was
is why we're here, and that is why you're in your living rooms or in your car or wherever you would be today. We're so thankful that you have chose to join us today. So welcome all you through Facebook, through other social media platforms, and even this morning, some of you will be tuning in to the radio, hopefully at 11:30. But we're so glad that you're with us, and even though we can't be together, we're grateful that in spirit we can be. And man, we want you to know that we do miss you. We love you deeply, but happy Resurrection Day. Amen. Turn to somebody around you, and if you're by yourself, give yourself a high five and say, go Jesus, man. We love our resurrected Lord. We're grateful to be here. You know, one of the visions that we have here at First Baptist Church is to get to know people so that we can let them know that they truly are known. They're known by a great God, and He knows them, so we want to know them. And He wants to leave them less alone, so we want to leave them less alone. So one of the things that we do is we ask a thing called a Kayla question. Kayla stands for known and less alone, and we do that here. And so I wonder if in your, whether you're gathered there, wherever you're gathered, you want to take a stab at this today. But our Kayla question today is simply this. If you can see it back here on our screen, it's what is your favorite Easter memory or the thing you like best about Easter Day? Now, I have a lot of answers, but I'll just give you one that comes to my mind when I think about this. When I was a young child, our whole entire community, I lived in a town about the size of LaGrange, and we had an entire community Easter egg hunt when I was fairly small. And I can remember there was this big prize. It was this massive radio that you could win. And man, back in that day, boomboxes were a big deal. So look that up on YouTube or Google if you don't know what that is. But there was this big radio, and man, that was the prize. And I'm telling you, we were poor, and I thought I would never win that. But man, I found the lucky egg and took that big radio home. And I will never forget that to this day. It was one of my greatest Easter memories. And that was back when my grandmother was still living, and she actually took me, and we celebrated that together. That's mine. Hey, turn to somebody there in your home, or maybe you just want to think about this if you're by yourself, and ask and answer that question today. And man, enjoy getting to know one another, even in your own home. Yeah. Well, hey, you know, as you guys continue to talk about that, I know you can talk about that the rest throughout your day. But hey, Pastor Justin, I wonder if you come right now and let's continue to worship our God through what you want to lead us through this morning.
I'd like to lead us in our offertory prayer this morning. Just want to remind you about the opportunities to give. You can go online. There'll be a link at the bottom of your screen there that you can go to, and you can give online. Second option to give is you can mail in your tithe to P.O. Box 97 here in LaGrange. Or if you'd like, you can come by the office and drop it off. You don't have to get out of your car. Just call us and we'll come out to you, or you can tape it to the door there. But we want to just encourage you in this time. Continue to faithfully give. Thank you for those of you that have continued to give. And then also just like to remind you, we're in the midst of taking up our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering goes to support home missions, so North American missions. So I'd encourage you as the Lord leads you to give to that. But would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, Lord God, we come before you, Father, and as it's been said, God, we just want to praise your name. Father, for you are worthy, God, of all the praise, honor, and glory. And Father, we celebrate today the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, thank you for all that you did for us on the cross. And thank you that through the power of your resurrection, that we too can have new life, which is found in you. Father, now we pray that you would bless these offerings, God, that you would use them for your glory and for the expansion of your kingdom, Father. And as always, we continue to pray that you would use your people here at First Baptist to make your name known in our community and throughout the state, throughout the world, God, wherever we go. So bless this offering, Father. And God, we pray for our pastor as he will come in a little bit to bring your word. We pray your blessings on him. We pray your anointing over him. Father, may the gospel go out today. Father, may it go forth and may it not return void. And Father, if there's anyone listening today or watching, God, that doesn't know you as Savior, Father, today, what better day than Easter than to come to know Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. So God, we honor you in this time, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to First Baptist Church LaGrange and happy Easter. We're so glad that you're here with us this morning. We want to remind you that today, right after this online service up at the church, we'll be having a drive-through. This will be a time when you can grab some Easter eggs to help distribute them to the kiddos in our church. We'll also have some set aside that you can take to give out to the kids in your neighborhood. This will be an awesome time for us to be able to connect with our community while still keeping our social distance. We look forward to seeing you guys soon. We just want to remind you guys that VBS is still on. It'll be June 7th through the 11th, and if you have a kiddo that wants to attend, please sign them up online. If this is your first time visiting with us today, we encourage you to go to our website to learn more about us. Now, let's continue to worship together.
Sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy.
mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet and my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began. Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you. Released from my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace so free washes over. Cursed tree.
his body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing.
Praise you for who you are, God, for loving us so much, God, for giving us hope, God, without you for what we're celebrating today, God, without you, we would not have that hope, and we just praise you so much for that. We just love you and praise you in your name. Amen.
Well, a man and his five-year-old son were driving past a cemetery, and they noticed a large pile of dirt next to a freshly dug grave. And his little boy looked over and said, "Look, Dad, one must have got out." Well, happy Resurrection Day, First Baptist Church, and to LaGrange, and to all of you listening by way of radio or Facebook or any other of the social media devices out there. Happy Resurrection Day. We hope you're having a good day in the midst of all this. We want you to know that we're here. We love this community, and we love our people in our church, and we really love really any and all people. We're grateful that we get to celebrate a resurrected King today. We are so very thankful that in the early church, there was a saying that said this: one person would say on a day like today, Christ is risen. And the answer and reply would be, he is risen indeed. And indeed, Jesus Christ has risen, and he has risen just as he said. So thinking about this day, I believe it's one of the most important days on the Christian calendar. At the same time, though, it addresses one of the most widespread myths about Christianity in our culture. Let me explain what I mean. It's really natural for people to want to divorce the moral teachings of Jesus from his supernatural life. I mean, people say things like this: Jesus, he's awesome. I mean, he forgave adulterers. That makes him really kind. He was against big religion and against the Roman Empire, and he stuck up for the poor. I mean, go Jesus. And that Sermon on the Mount thing, man, it brings tears to my eyes every time. Well, everybody's good with Jesus, right, up to that point. But when you get to the point about him rising from the dead and saying that no one can be saved unless they come through me, well, that's a different story. See, here's really the problem that we have. The Apostle Paul said that if the resurrection is not true, then everything else that Christianity teaches is worthless. Someone might say, well, that's Paul's opinion. I just accept the parts about Christianity, about God being love and how we should love and forgive, and I'm just going to reject the rest. Okay, but where did you get that God is love and that we should forgive one another? I mean, where did that come from? I mean, for example, everybody seems to love 1 Corinthians 13 and they like to have it read in their weddings. It's that familiar passage that says things like this: love is patient, love is kind, it does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth, it never fails. That passage, it's super familiar, right? But guess who wrote that? You're right, the Apostle Paul did. And Paul goes on to say in 1 Corinthians 15 that if the resurrection didn't happen, then 1 Corinthians 13 and all the teaching about love is simply useless. So if you don't believe in the resurrection, Paul would say, then why would you want to quote 1 Corinthians 13 in your wedding? Right? We hear so much that God is love. But again, where did you learn that? Somebody's probably going to say, from my grandma. Well, where did your grandma get it? She got it from the Apostle John, who said in 1 John 4:8 that God is love. But you see, that same Apostle John who said that God is love also said that anyone who denies the resurrection of Jesus is a liar and a false prophet. So here's really the dilemma that we have. Everything that you and I appreciate about Jesus came from people who believed that Jesus rose from the dead. So in light of that, I want to share with you a story that Jesus told a group of people. It's one of the most famous short stories in the world. Charles Dickens once said, it's the finest short story ever written. This morning, I don't want you to hear it as a simple story. I want you to hear it really as the truth. This is a story that Jesus told that basically summarized his entire life, a life whose defining moment was death and resurrection. And it's the story, you guessed it, of the prodigal son. At the end of my message, though, I'm going to offer each and every person within the sound of my voice a chance to respond and to trust Christ personally as their Lord and Savior for themselves and to really, truly be loved by this resurrected King. Nevertheless, the story is a summation of Jesus' life, a life that is defined by the cross and resurrection. So let's all turn to Luke chapter 15 in our Bibles. If you can find a copy of God's Word, maybe on your phone, maybe on your living room stand there, or whatever it would be, maybe you can break out something that you found just lying around. I don't know. Get Luke 15 and turn there. There are three main characters in the story of the prodigal son. There's the younger son, and he's usually referred as the prodigal. There's the older son, and he has a very important role in the story. And of course, there is the father. But before we get really into it, I need you to know there's a couple of things that we usually get wrong about the story. The first one is that most people think that the main character of the story is the runaway or prodigal son. But the main character in the story is really the father. The father is mentioned no less than 12 times in the span of 20 verses. Secondly, we think that the word prodigal means runaway. But the word prodigal really means reckless or wasteful. It means to spend until you have nothing left. The word prodigal appears only one time in the story, and it appears in reference to the son squandering all of his father's money. And I'm going to show you that when you see the bigger point in the story, the word prodigal probably refers and applies better to the father than it does the son, because the story is about the recklessness of God's love. So as I tell you this story, I'm going to point out and highlight the love of God being spoken about throughout this parable. So if you're with me in Luke chapter 15, let's begin reading in verse 11. Luke 15, verse 11. The Bible says this: "And he said, a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the estate that falls to me.' So he divided his wealth between them. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country, and there he squandered his estate with loose living. Now, when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would have gladly filled his stomach with the pods that the swine were eating, and no one was giving anything to him. But when he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread? But I am dying here of hunger. I will get up, go to my father, and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me as one of your hired men.' So he got up and he came to his father. But listen, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his slaves, 'Quickly, bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fattened calf. Kill it. Let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and he has been found.' And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field. And when he came and approached the house, he heard music and dancing. And he summoned one of the servants and began inquiring what these things could be. And he said to him, 'Your brother has come home, and your father's killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound.' But he became angry and was not willing to go in. And his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, 'Look, for so many years I've been serving you, and I've never neglected a command of yours, and yet you have never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours come, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him?' And he said to him, 'Son, you've always been with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate and rejoice, for this brother of yours was dead and has begun to live. It was lost and has been found.'" May God bless the reading of his powerful word. Here's the first thing I want us to know and realize this morning from this parable. And that is simply this: that God loves you even when you've rejected him personally. God loves you even when you've rejected him personally. Back in verse 11, there's a story. A man had two sons. Verse 12, the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of the estate that falls me." So he divided his wealth between them. You see, we see very quickly that the younger son wants his dad's provision, but he no longer wants his dad personally. It's hard to imagine anything more painful for a father, right? Think about it. His son is basically saying, "My preference would be for you just to die so I can have your money. But since that ain't happening, I just want to take your stuff and I'm going to go away." I can't imagine anything more painful that I would experience than for my kids to one day say to me, We have no desire for a personal relationship with you anymore, Dad. We don't even want to be around you. We don't want our kids to know you. Just give us your money and get out of our lives. And how would that break your heart? I mean, that would destroy me. You see, the text tells us that God loves you even when you reject him personally. But please know that because he loves you, when you reject him, it absolutely breaks his heart. You see, in this story, Jesus is giving us a picture of what sin is like. You see, some of us have all participated in sin at some level. Honestly speaking, we don't really want God in our lives. We don't want his control or his rules. We don't value or need his love. You see, at its core, sin is really a big I problem. It's the middle letter of the word sin. It's the letter I. Sin is a big I problem because sin means that I want to be in charge. I want to be in control. I want to be the point. People think of sin often as these just gross, wicked acts. And while they are that, in its essence, sin is really when I want to be my own Lord. But you see, here's the kicker. When God is around, I can't be in control and call the shots. So then I'll just go away from God and ignore God. For all practical purposes then, we say God is dead. But notice, here comes the first major surprise in the story. Because even though this son chose his sin and chose to reject his father personally, watch the surprise because it's in verse 12. The Bible says, so the father gave in and divided his wealth amongst his sons. Now, you may not know this, but in the book of Leviticus, it says that you could have a rebellious son like that executed. And on that point, New Testament scholar Kenneth Bailey says, first century Jewish custom dictated that if a Jewish boy rejected the family, the community would break a large pot in front of him and cry out, so-and-so is cut off from his people. This ceremony was called the kazaza, which literally means the cutting off. And after it was performed, the community would have nothing to do with this wayward person. But that's not what this father did. He continues to love his son. So again, God loves you. He loves you even when you've rejected him. And he loves you even though you've broken his heart. You see, before you even thought about God, even thought about turning back to him, before you even thought about turning from your sin, God has set his love on you and he's not stopped loving you and will never stop loving you. But here's the second thing today. The second thing is this. God loves you as you roam in the pain of sin. God loves you as you roam in the pain of sin. Go back to verse 13. And not many days later, the younger son gathered everything together and went on a journey into a distant country. And there he squandered his estate with loose living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine occurred in that country, and he began to be impoverished. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, and he set him into his fields to feed swine. You see, as this younger son started this new life, things seemed to be going great. He went to the far country, away from the father, away from the rules, and got everything that money could buy. But then, however, the winds began to change, as they always do. See, now the money was gone. The friends were gone. Loneliness came and set in, and that turned to begging, and despair quickly followed. And the journey ends with him taking the lowest job in Israel, feeding pigs, which were considered unclean animals. And he became so hungry that he even craved to eat what the pigs were eating. But see, that is the picture of the trajectory of sin. It usually starts out great. I mean, did you know that the Bible even says there's pleasure in sin? I mean, it's crazy to me that some people think that sin is not pleasurable or that sin is not fun. I mean, if that's been your experience or that's your belief, you simply ain't sinning right. I mean, I'm just telling you. But you see, listen to me. There's a second part to that verse and that principle in Scripture. While there's pleasure in sin, the Bible says it's only for a season. And it begins with delight, but it ends with you and I roaming in pain. You see, this morning, I know this with all my heart. Some of you are there. Maybe you're roaming around in the pain of sexual sin. I mean, when people have some deep wound they want to talk to me about, sometimes it always involves something to do with that kind of sin. Maybe it's someone you did something with and you may not even know their name, or it's a string of somebody's, or maybe someone who's no longer around and they promised you that they would be, or maybe something has been done to you and you carry the shame with that around. Maybe this morning you're roaming around in the pain of being in the pin pen of broken relationship after broken relationship. Maybe you're roaming in the pain of the consequences that have caused you to lose your family, lose your job, even your dignity. Maybe you're roaming in the pain of a secret sin that you've never confessed, and it is simply eating you alive. You see, as with sin, the path you chose promised so much, but it hasn't led where it promised, and now you're roaming in pain. You see, I was reading about Angelina Jolie, and she says she remembered one of the most upsetting times in her life was after she had finally achieved success, financial stability, and she was in love. And she said this, "I have everything they say you're supposed to have to be happy, but I am not really happy." Eminem, the famous rapper, said this, "You have to be careful what you wish for. I always wish for this, but it has become more of a nightmare than a dream." Listen, beloved, there's an old saying, and I believe it's true. It goes like this. Sin will always take you further than you want to go, cost you more than you want to pay, and keep you longer than you want to stay. You see, maybe that's where you are this morning, in the far country, roaming in the pain of sin. And no matter where you're at, please know this, that God loves you during your roaming. He loves you as you roam in the pain. You see, you should think of this story as kind of a split screen. On the one side of the screen is the son and his reckless living, and on the other side is this father with his reckless loving. You see, God never stops loving us, even when we roam in the pain of sin. Never, ever ceasing to love us is our great God. And here's the third thing I want you to know this resurrection morning. God loves you as he recklessly pursues you. God loves you as he recklessly pursues you. Because look down in verse 17. The Bible says that when the son came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have more than enough bread, but I'm dying here with hunger?" You see, the son woke up. It finally clicked. He came to his senses. But let me tell you how this happened. You see, let me point out something that you may not readily notice. You see, it looks like the son is the one who's deciding to come back. But this is the third story in a row that Jesus tells about finding something that is lost. You see, earlier up in Luke 15, we read about a lost coin. And a woman had 10 coins, and she lost one somewhere in her house. She didn't rejoice that she still had 9. She scoured her house. She swept everything. She pulled up cushions until she found the one lost coin, and then she celebrated. Then we read about a story about a lost sheep. This guy had 100 sheep, and one was lost. He didn't rejoice that he had the 99. He went looking and searching feverishly for the one that was lost. He searched so hard, and he finally found it, and then he rejoiced in this one that was found. Now see, you may not connect with either of those, a coin or a sheep, but I'm sure everybody can relate to what it's like to lose $20 from your wallet. I mean, you lose $20 and you search all through your pants, you know, and then you look all through the car, you look all through the house, and while $20 will not break you, you simply have to find it. How about when you lose your credit card? Anybody ever lost your credit card, right? That feeling of panic when you can't find your credit card is pretty real, right? You're not content with the other 6 you have in your wallet, right? You just got to find the one that you've lost. So let's go back to the story, and let me continue to show you how this is really about the father bringing the son back more than it's about the son deciding to come back. Because in verse 17, it says, when he came to his senses, right? Verse 18, "Well, I'll get up and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son,'" right? Verse 20, "So he got up and came to his father." But watch this word, the word "but." "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion for him." Now, you have to understand something. In the context of what we've just talked about, the lost coin and the lost sheep, Jesus tells this story as the climax of his trilogy about lost things. And this is the climax, is the finding of the lost son. You see, we're anxious to find lost money or even to find a lost sheep, but we get incredibly, incredibly desperate to find a lost child. I mean, have you ever been in Walmart and your kids are with you? They're having fun, goofing off, and then you turn around and like, they're not there. Have you ever had that happen? If you have, I'm praying for you right now, because there's nothing on this planet that can compare to the panic and fear and desperation that comes in your heart when you think you've lost your child. See, here's the point. That's the same desperation God feels about his children when they are lost. And he does everything to seek them and to find them. So what I know is while it may not be here at first glance, the Father is really the one seeking. That's why it says the Father saw him, because the Father was the one who was seeking. This is consistent with who God is, because in Luke chapter 19:10, the Bible tells us that the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost. That's who Jesus is. The Apostle John explains to us that we come to the Father only as he draws us. It tells us that in John chapter 6, verse 44, that no man can come to the Father unless he draws him to him. So in verse 24, if you'll look in your text in Luke 15, verse 24 says, "For this son of mine was dead and has come to life. He was lost and he's been found." Who found him? The Father found him, because the Father was seeking the Son and drawing him to himself. You see, God arranges the circumstances of your life to draw you to himself. He's working through all kinds of things in your lives. Maybe it's pain. Maybe it's a broken marriage. Maybe it's a failed career. Maybe it's something that you thought was secure but is simply falling apart. Maybe you started to look at your family and your kids are getting older, and that empty nest idea is setting in and flooding your heart with all kinds of emotions and feelings. I mean, it could be the scare of death. I mean, right now we're dealing with this coronavirus and people are panicking and afraid and people are dying. And that's legitimate and real, but God could be using that to seek you. It could be a financial crisis, as many have been recently hit because of this virus. It could be the loneliness that you're experiencing, the desperation you feel right now because of the isolation and the restrictions while this time is happening. Listen, through any and all of this, God is drawing you. He's seeking you because he's recklessly pursuing you, even though you might be roaming in pain. Even though you might have chosen to reject him personally, he is drawing you and bringing you to your senses. Now listen, I'm not a prophet, nor am I the son of a prophet. But I know for many of you listening this morning, Jesus has been seeking you and pursuing you through the events that have led up to this very weekend. Listen, it is not an accident that you have joined us through Facebook. It is not an accident right now that you're listening to this particular radio station at this particular time. You may have felt that it was a random invitation from a friend, or maybe you saw one of our flyers go out from our church, you received it in email, and you thought, these people are crazy, let me go check out what they're really doing. Or maybe you're just flipping through the radio stations, and you thought, this guy sounds stupid, let me just check him out and see what things he can say so I can make fun of him. I don't know, but I can tell you this, I know God is using it to seek you right now. Let's look again in verse 20, because verse 20 tells us something. It says this, that his father saw him and felt compassion for him and ran and embraced and kissed him. Did you see that? You see, you have to understand that in that time, grown men never ran. Even in our day, grown men really don't run unless it's for sport, right? I mean, if you see a grown man running through the mall, it's either because he's committed a crime or because somebody's trying to commit one against him. You see, men in those days wore long robes and they were not good for running. And no one even in our day shows up to the Boston Marathon in a long robe that's ankle length, right? Nobody does that. So this father had to lift up the front of his robe and expose his knees, something that was considered deeply shameful in that culture. And you see, what God is teaching us is there comes a time When the emotion of seeking something that is lost so dominates your heart that you will forget everything and you will become reckless with your love. That is why it is better to think of the father being the prodigal than it is the son. The father was the one who was wasteful. The father was the one who was reckless with his love. He pushed everything else aside and loved his son and pursued him no matter the cost. It's like the father was shaming himself, but he didn't care because he is going to get his son back. I mean, did you see it in verse 20? It says when the father saw his son. He saw his son even though he was a long way off. And that tells me that the father never stops drawing. The father never stops seeking. The father never stops loving. The father is quick, ready, and even longing to show you his love. God loves you as he recklessly pursues you. Now, here's the fourth thing we want to learn this morning. God loves you as he runs passionately to you. God loves you as he runs passionately to you. Did you see there at the end of verse 20, it says this, that he ran and embraced him and kissed him. I mean, have you ever had that moment? Have you ever had that moment when suddenly in your spirit, God's voice whispers to you in the tenderness of his love, telling you that though you've run away, he's never given up on you? You see, I wasn't raised in the church. I wasn't really raised around the church. I went into the army right after high school, and I was overseas in Germany and met some missionaries who were ministering to soldiers. They provided the kind of a home away from home. Man, the lady there, she was a great cook, and she provided great home cooking, which is better than mess hall food any day. And they provided so many of the wonderful things. But I remember them coming around our post with their van, offering rides down to their house. And I would see them coming, and I would run and hide from them. Because I knew how I was living. And just seeing them brought conviction to my heart. But one night I gave in and I went with them. And we all went to their house and then we went to a church service afterwards. And I can remember there was a pastor just like me preaching from the Bible just like I'm doing right now. And I can remember I never heard the things he was saying. I can remember as he was preaching the word of God, man, my heart was being broken over the way I was living, over my sin, over my life, over the things that I had chosen. I was deeply convicted in my heart. At the end of that service, I was literally driven to my knees. And I was there weeping and broken in front of God and everybody. And I felt like the floor was getting hot and that it was going to open up and hell was going to consume me. I was so scared. I did not know what to do. I knew that I had sinned against God. I knew that I deserved his judgment. And I was so afraid and I didn't know what to do. And nobody helped me. Nobody came up to me. Nobody told me what to do. So after about 30, 40 minutes, I got up off my knees and I simply went home. And as I opened my front door, there was a mirror there. And I looked in that mirror and I saw myself for the first time as God really saw me. I was one who had deeply sinned against God, but yet I was one whom God deeply loved. I mean, I felt completely exposed. I knew that God was confronting me, revealing my brokenness, my shame, my sin, and my guilt. But at the same time, he was speaking to me that he loved me. And I was completely undone. God had demonstrated through that service that he knew every one of my secrets, yet he loved me anyway. And I still, at this point, didn't know what to do. Then almost out of nowhere, there was one Bible verse that I'd heard as a kid. And it was a verse that maybe you know. It was John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. How I remember that, I do not know. But the Spirit of God spoke the word of God in my heart and I simply then knew what to do. I got back down on my knees and I asked Jesus Christ to forgive me. I asked Jesus Christ to come into my life, to save me, to make me new, to cleanse me, to be my Lord. I put my faith in what he did on a cross. I put my faith in his burial and his resurrection. And I said, God, save me. And beloved, I'm telling you, he did. I got up off my knees that night and I was a changed new man. I was overwhelmed with the passionate love of God for me. It was as if God stepped into that room and put his ever-loving arms around me and kissed me with the kiss of heaven. And I've never, ever been loved like that. You see, John 3:16 says that God so loved the world. Well, how did he so love us? Because Romans 5:8 tells us this, but God demonstrates his love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That to be demonstrate means to put on display. And God put his love on display when Jesus got upon the cross. But it says, the Bible says that now what? Now what do I do that God has demonstrated his love to me? He says, believe. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes. Believe means to place your personal faith and trust in what Jesus did for you. To turn from your sin, to turn from the lordship of your life, and to turn to Jesus. And what happens when you do that? John 3:16 says that you will never perish but have everlasting life. You can go from life to death today. That's what the cross is all about. That's what Easter is all about. That's what our resurrected Jesus is. And that's exactly what the Father said had happened to his son. Because look in verse 24. For this son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and he has been found. But you see, you've got to remember that the Father loved him before the son ever did anything. And if you stop right now, wherever you're doing, if you're driving, if you're doing some cross stitch, I don't care what you're doing right now. If you will stop right now, you will hear the voice of God telling you what I've been telling you right now through this story. That God loves you and he's running passionately towards you and wants to wrap you in his loving embrace. He will do that this morning if you will let him. But here's another thing that we have to learn this morning. That God loves you as he rewards you personally. God loves you as he rewards you personally. God will cover you with grace and make everything new. Just like me, when I got off my knees that day, I told you I was a new man and everything in my life had become completely new. Look there in verse 22 in our text this morning. But the father said to the slaves, quickly bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. Now, by the way, did you notice that the son never got through his prepared speech? I mean, the son had planned to tell his dad about his plan to become a servant and to work off his debt, but his dad cuts him off, and his dad says to the servants, hey, bring out a robe, bring out a ring, and bring out some sandals. The three best gifts, because a robe, the robe would have been the best robe, would have been the one that belonged to the father. And you've got to see that this son is now being clothed in the garments of the father. He puts a ring on him. The ring was a symbol of authority. He's now been given the authority to become a son again. He puts sandals on his feet. That was a sign of wealth. Servants didn't wear shoes in the house. Only sons did. You know what he's telling him? You're a son now. You see, in our text, the son has requested the status of a servant, but he's been denied by God Almighty. Why? Because he's been restored as a son. And that can happen to you this morning. You see, the father knows that his son will face shame when he comes back to the village. So the father lifts his robe up and takes the shame upon himself, the humiliation upon himself, and runs out to rescue his son from what he ultimately deserves. But the father doesn't stop there. He covers his son with honor. Listen to me very carefully. Our natural reaction when we know we've sinned against God is to try and work it off. But God will have none of that. You see, you can't know God that way. You have to know God on the basis of grace and not on good deeds and not on good works and not on religious ceremonies and not on anything that you and I can bring. It's all by God's grace. Think about it with me if you will. Where is the shame from what the son did? It's gone. I mean, the only one who experiences any shame in this story is the father as he runs to his son. Where's the punishment in this text? There's not a drop of it because the father absorbs it all. I mean, who pays for the reckless living of the son? Not the son. The father absorbs it. You see, the sweetest, richest word in all of Christianity, the one people find the hardest to believe is that word called grace. So now, let me help explain to you why this story is really about Jesus' death and resurrection and why we would discuss this story on Easter morning. You see, the cross is Jesus running after us, taking on himself our shame. Jesus was beaten. He was spat upon. He experienced merciless beatings with a cat of nine tails made of glass and metal and bone. He had nails driven in his hands and his feet. It was so painful that men would weep, vomit, and urinate all over themselves. The Romans would crucify these men naked in a public place. And this was Jesus, and this is what happened to him to bear our sin and our shame. Do you understand what the cross is? The cross is Jesus taking the place for your rebellion and wayward living. You see, the cross for many people in our culture is a decoration. It's a decoration. It's a symbol of faith. But you see, that's not really what the cross is. The cross is not a decoration. The cross is a declaration. It's a declaration that you and I deserve condemnation, but Jesus took our place and offers us restored intimacy as sons if we choose to receive it. You see, the resurrection is Jesus making all things new. Think about the robe. The robe is really a symbol of the cross. It's where Jesus took the garments of our sin and put them in the grave and has clothed us in the righteousness of God the Father. And when you and I encounter Jesus, we are clothed in Christ's righteousness. What about the ring? The resurrection is where he gave us the ring of new life, the authority and the power to overcome sin and corruption, the authority and ability to put our families back together, to escape the curse over our lives and to make all things new. You see, when you and I come to Jesus in faith, we are given Christ's authority over sin, Satan, hell, and the grave, amen. Then we've been given sandals. The cross and the resurrection are where Jesus put on our feet the sandals of our privileged position with the Father so that we can come boldly into his presence like sons and not slaves. It's kind of like the president. Not just anyone can get into his presence. But on the other hand, his kids have instant access to him anytime. And when you and I come to Jesus, we are given all things that belong to Christ and have become heirs with him as sons. Oh, beloved, if the cross and resurrection are not true, then this is just a quaint story with no real meaning. If, however, they are true, then it means God is the true prodigal, the one who spent until he had nothing left, who ran to you, who gave it all up for you, and now offers to clothe you in power and grace and position. You see, if the cross and resurrection actually happened, it means that there are none of us who are beyond the reach of God's grace. There's no sin too wicked. There's no country you've run to that's too far. There's no recklessness too severe. There's no shame too great. No corruption too advanced. And no pig pen too filthy. Jesus is able to save to the uttermost all those who come to God through him. If the cross and resurrection are true, your history does not have to determine your identity or your destiny. Your future is not defined by your past mistakes, but by the promises of God. A God who can make all things new and can clothe you in power. It's a gift for you simply to receive. You see, if the cross and resurrection are true, then there's nothing you could do that will make God love you any more. And there's nothing you have done that will make God love you any less. Someone has said this, what is grace? Well, grace is simply an acronym, I believe, and it stands this for this. Grace is really God's riches at Christ's expense. You see, you get the position of the son because Jesus, God's perfect son, pays the price and takes your position of rebellion. I'm going to give you an opportunity in just a few moments to receive that kind of grace, but let's talk about two more things. Let's continue with this sixth thing, and that is this, that God loves you even when you renounce his provision. God loves you even when you renounce his provision, because verse 28 says this, but this son, this older son, became angry and was not willing to go in, and his father came out and began pleading with him. But he answered and said to his father, look, for so many years I've served you and never neglected a command of yours, yet you've never given me a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes, who has devoured your wealth with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. Now see, you have to listen to what's really happening here in the text. You see, this brother on the surface looks like the opposite of the younger son, doesn't he? I mean, this brother's good and he's upright. But you have to notice one of the most critically important details in this text about the older brother. Please look with me, if you will, and see this. You have to see this. Verse 28, it says, but he became angry and was not willing to go in. Did you see it? The older brother is outside the house. You see, Jesus has a very specific person in mind when he's telling this parable. It's the religious person who's lived a really good life, done all the right things, behaved morally, and thinks they have a relationship with God because of this. Sadly, they have never experienced God's grace and have no relationship with God and are simply outside the kingdom and family of God. This brother is not like his father at all. He hates his brother. He may be near the house of his father, but he doesn't have the heart of his father. And did you ever notice that religious people can be some of the most unloving people on the planet? I mean, they're self-righteous, and many of them are haters. And some of you have been victims of that. That's simply because religion cleans you up on the outside without changing what's on the inside. Now, if you have kids, and I have some, and hopefully you do, you know that one of the most important parts of trying to raise them is the potty training stage, right? And if you don't have kids, just wait. It gets really good. Potty training stage is the weirdest time in your life. I mean, think about it. When you're potty training, you applaud poop. I mean, your kids will come up to you and say, look what I did. And you're going to go, yay, you pooped in the potty, right? Now, the one thing that goes on during this time is they like to do things by themselves, right? And those things don't always go together. I mean, sometimes your child, when they're potty training, will disappear in the bathroom for a long time. Now, if you're a guy and you go into the bathroom for a long time, that's not a problem, right? I mean, because guys can spend 6 hours in a bathroom. They like to read through the back issues of Motor Trends magazine. They put a small lawnmower together while they're in there. No problem, right? No big deal. But if a four-year-old goes in there and if a four-year-old girl goes in there for a long time, that's a problem. So it's not uncommon to hear things coming out of the bathroom after they've been in there for a while. And you go in to investigate and the smell instantly hits you. Then to your utter amazement, there's your child beside the toilet and poop is everywhere. I mean, it's on their arms, their face, on the sink, on the walls. It's everywhere. And you ask, how did this happen? And they go, look, Daddy, I wiped by myself. You see, beloved, that's what religion is. It's trying to wipe and clean yourself. And it usually leaves you in a more stinky state. And I know that illustration may seem vile and nasty. And I'm not trying to gross you out, but I'm telling you that's what sin's like. It's nasty. And the more we try to clean it up ourselves by doing good things, just makes it worse. It's like trying to clean the exterior without changing the heart. Because Isaiah 64:6 says this, that our righteousness is like filthy rags to God. You see, religion and good deeds are like used women's feminine products. Religion actually doesn't change the heart. It only leads to pride and more self-righteousness. And see, what God wants is a change of heart. And that can't happen by you and I resolving to do better. It doesn't happen by saying religious prayers. It never happens by lighting a bunch of candles. It won't happen by taking communion, by being baptized, by doing good works, by giving time, talent, and treasure to the church. It doesn't happen by just simply promising to be better or to do good or to become more moral. It doesn't happen by trusting some bread and some wine or having somebody say that you've been forgiven in a confessional booth. It doesn't happen by trusting in baptism as a child. It happens when you experience the new birth in Jesus Christ by God's grace, by placing your personal faith in Jesus, what he did, and turning from your sin and turning to Jesus. Listen, you and I can't use toilet paper to keep us from going to the bathroom. You and I cannot use good works and religious things to keep us right with God. There has to be a change from the inside, and this is what Jesus and the cross does. That's why I needed Jesus and why you need Jesus. Our sin is nasty and disgusting, but Jesus steps into the bathroom of our sin when we're covered with poop and he cleans us up. That's why we have to experience what he did, not our own efforts, friends. We come to place our faith in Jesus and Jesus alone to make us right. We have to have a point in time, asking him at a point in time to forgive us and to save us. Hearing him declare to us not guilty, we have to hear that. And if that's never happened to you, listen to me, beloved. I mean this from the most sincere place in my heart. I mean it with love. But if that's never happened to you, you are still outside the house. But there's good news. You can come home today. Because God loves you during the time when you're too proud to receive his grace and you renounce his provision. You can continue to try to clean yourself up and it won't work. But nevertheless, God still loves you. And what I want you to understand is this. We believe that God loves the wayward sinner, but he also loves the lost religious person. And according to Jesus, two people missed the gospel, the wayward and the self-righteous, which leads me to my final point. And that is simply this. You can choose to refuse Jesus Christ permanently. You can refuse to receive Jesus Christ permanently. You see, interestingly, this story never resolves. It ends abruptly in verse 32. I mean, does the older son receive the father's invitation and come back in, or does he stay outside? You see, it doesn't say, because this story itself is an invitation. This morning, I'm asking you, will you receive God's offer of forgiveness, restoration, salvation, hope, heaven, and power by coming to the resurrected Lord? God won't force it on you. You have to choose to receive it. But listen, you simply can choose to refuse. You can choose to refuse him permanently. But listen, once you die, you can never undo that choice. I mean this with all my heart. I'm not trying to be divisive. I'm just preaching God's word. There isn't anything like purgatory that can ever change that decision. Prayers from saints will not help you. No amount of burning candles will help you. There are no second chances. There are no reincarnations. This is not about karma and good outweighing the bad. This is not about anything else but Jesus and Jesus alone. He loves you and he has done everything possible for you to come inside the house. The Father is waiting for you. And you can know for sure where you stand with God. Because Jesus said in John 14, 6, he said this, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. And no one comes to the Father but through me. You can do that today. You can get to the Father's house through Jesus today. You can come home. Jesus has paid it all. And he's offering you salvation right now. And the only moment that you have been guaranteed is the one that you're in right now. And I pray with all of my heart that you would choose Jesus today. Please, I beg you, don't be the older son. Be the prodigal and come home. Here's my question. Have you ever had the very simple experience of receiving Jesus Christ personally into your life? Well, right now, I want to give you that opportunity. If my band would make their way up to this platform, that would be wonderful. And as they begin to play softly in the background, I want to ask you to consider some questions. Are you ready right now to come to your senses? Are you ready to come home? Are you ready to turn from your sin and to come to Jesus? I mean, are you ready to experience love like you've never been loved before? Are you ready to be treated like a son of God? Oh, he loves you so very, very much. So right now, right where you are, maybe you're driving somewhere right now. Maybe you just need to pull off on the side of the road and focus in. Maybe right now you were doing multiple things while listening to this message. Now I ask you to turn off everything and to pay attention to me. If you need Jesus and you need to be forgiven, you want to come home, you want to get on the inside of the house, I'm simply going to ask you to pray a prayer from your heart. The prayer doesn't make you right. Jesus makes you right. But I want you to do business with God from your heart, believing with your heart, not your head, but with your heart. Would you pray a prayer like this to the Lord? If you're ready to make yourself right with God, you're ready to trust Jesus, his death, burial, and resurrection for you, I ask you right now within the sound of my voice, would you pray something like this to your King? Would you pray with me right now? Jesus, I thank you today that you love me. I thank you that you've convicted me and broken my heart over my sin. Would you please forgive me? Would you have mercy on me? Would you come into my life and make me new? Jesus, I believe you died to pay for my sin. I believe you were buried and my sin can be covered. I believe that you were raised again to give me life, and I want it. Jesus, save me. I turn from my sin and I run to your love. Thank you. Thank you so much for saving me. Fill me with power to live for you. I want to love you more. I want to know you more. Show me what home looks like. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, if you prayed that prayer, I'd love to know. Go onto our website, look up my email. Send me an email. Shoot anybody on our staff an email. I want to do something here. I want to give you my personal cell phone number. My personal cell phone number is 979-702-8133. 979-702-8133. If you prayed that and you've done business with God, I'd love to talk to you more. But if you have questions and you just couldn't take that step today, but you're thinking about it and want to talk, I'm here. I want to minister to you in any way I can. But Jeremy, I wonder today, brother, can we sing celebrating coming home to this great love of the King? Would you sing with us?
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. So I run to the Father again and again and again.
good song, and I'm so glad that you were singing it with us. It's one of my favorite songs. It's kind of out there. It's kind of my story, as you heard. I want to say thank you for joining us today, and I want to invite you to kind of tune in next week as we begin a new series called Family Matters. Family does matter, but we're going to talk about family matters. Things like, what is the purpose of parenting? What is really the passion of parenting? And we're going to also deal with the pain of parenting. We're going to give some practical tools, and so I just want to let you know kind of what's coming so you can be in prayer. Hey, don't forget to continue to invite people to join in with us and continue to pray. And we're here, but we wanted to let you know, happy Resurrection Day. He is risen. He is risen indeed. May God bless you.